So, our next guest, if I was a talk show host, our next guest is Sofia Selly, and she is going to come on stage. She is going to make a case for OTR. I want us all, if she's going to stand up here and make a case to us about why it's important, I want us all to start off skeptical. So I want everybody to kind of cross their arms at first. Can we do that real fast? There we go. Now, when she comes on stage, I want her to look out into a sea of skeptical people as she makes her case. All right? We are ready to go, are we not? So I'm going to pass this off to her. Go ahead and tell us the state of secure messaging, OTR stuff. Take it away.
Hello. Thank you so much for that introduction. So last year I did give a talk already about OTR version 4, but today it's more about like the different state that different secure messaging applications have been having and what kind of security properties they're actually given. So the first thing, of course, is the question that I always start, because this might be obvious for a lot of people attending this conference, but it's not obvious for end users that are actually using this kind of applications. So the question is why we actually need this kind of applications and this kind of protocols and this kind of ideas. So why we need secure communication? And for this, as always, I always like to refer to this cryptographic paper by a very nice cryptographer by the name of Philip Rogoway, who says that one of the most important things that you can actually think about when you are developing or thinking about cryptography is the problem of actually giving secure communication. And he says that even ever since David Shom introduced this problem like 20 years ago, there has not been that much research or really applied research around secure communication. And what he argues is also actually that there has been some research and some applications of security properties, but not so many of privacy properties. In the sense that, of course, you have, for example, WhatsApp, who introduces like end-to-end encryption, and that will be the security part of it. But there's not much applications who actually introduce privacy properties, like maybe anonymity or maybe deniability or other kinds of privacy properties. And what he argues also is that there's not such thing as security without actually these privacy properties. And the other thing that you have, of course, on cryptography and also in software development is that you have a mountain of ideas. Very few of them actually get implemented or actually get used by users. So we still have that. I'm sure that everybody here has like maybe 6 applications of secure messaging installs on the phone. And that's a lot of ideas. So maybe we should actually start making only one very big idea instead of actually enforcing users to install like 10 applications. And the other question that you can pose is, do user understands why? Like that people that walk around the street actually know that they need secure communication, they know why these properties are needed? That's also a question to be asked. Okay, so why is this important? Because obviously if you're using the digital world, if you're using the internet, you're using it to have some sort of communication. To chat to someone, to maybe do some transaction with your bank, which is also a form of communication. To back up some data, which means that that's a form of communication for yourself in the future. So you're using for that. And what is oftentimes used in the digital world is that this is a social and political problem, in the sense that you will have adversaries who will try to look at your network and find out what you're talking to, whom you're talking to, what you're talking about, because it has political and social implications, and it's really important for certain governments to actually surveil certain citizens because of the kind of communications they might be having. So this is a problem that is not only like theoretical or from a cryptographic, really academic standpoint of view, but actually this has implications in real life. Now, the current state of things is that we have lots of applications, but we actually need options that actually work, and we need options that are fully specified, where properties are correctly mapped, where limitations are correctly defined, and when the issues, if there exist, so are correctly stated. And we also need protocols that actually update the definitions. We don't need protocols that started like in 2000s and never got updated. We need things that actually work with the current state of the art of the cryptographic ideas that exist out there. We need reviews and verifications, because there exists a lot of applications that have never been securely audited or formally verified. And we actually need so to actually know that we are giving users what they need. We also need ideas from different places, in the sense that, yes, there's a lot of applications of secure messaging applications that work, but maybe they only work for certain parts of the world. So actually having ideas from different regions and different places will be nice. Okay. So that's communications in general. And of course, there's a lot of protocols that solve certain types of communication. Like you will have the TLS protocol to actually solve the problem of having secure communication between your client and your server. But if you want to have casual conversations or chats with someone, that's a different problem. That's a messaging protocol problem. So what the first people who were thinking about how to resolve and make secure this casual communication were thinking, they were first thinking about, okay, so the first thing that we need to do is to actually go and map what are the properties that we have in real world conversations, on the physical world. What are the properties that we have so we can map them into the digital world? What we have in real world communications is that we know who participates in the conversation because we see face to face the other person, or if it's by phone, we hear the voice of the other person. We know what's it said because, of course, you're into the conversation, so you know. You know who's listening in because unless you like walk around and see someone trying to chime in into your conversation, you know who is trying to chime in. And you know how long it lasts because it's not recorded by audio or by video. You know that it would stop the minute you say bye and the conversation ended. So the properties you have is that you can deny having participated into this conversation because I have can have a conversation with my friend. And if this friend later go and says like, yeah, this person said this and that, so you should like accuse this person of this, I can always deny having said so. And there's no record that I actually said so. You can choose who listens to it because if someone is trying to chime in, you can say like, hey, dude, what are you trying to do? And you can stop that. You can choose how long it lasts because unless you say, yes, I want this to be recorded, no one, or at least some most countries, should be able to record that conversation. And you know something of the identity of whom you're talking to because you are seeing this person face to face, so at least you know how they look like. That's are the properties that they mapped, and because of this, they created a very nice paper in 2004. Some three cryptographers by the name of Ian Goldberg, Nikita Borisov, and Eric Brewer. What they did is that they mapped these properties from real-world conversations, and they say, okay, the current protocols that we have, which were like SSL and PGP, do they give us the properties that we mapped from the real-world conversations? What they say is that no, they don't give us those properties. Why? Because if you use protocols like PGP, you will actually create a proof of authorship. If you use PGP to sign your messages, you will always be creating like a proof saying, this is the signature attached to my message, so I actually set whatever the contents of the message are. And you cannot deny it. So if someone goes with that proof to a court or to someone, they will actually say, yes, you actually said so because here's your signature. And the other problem that they find it is that, they give you end-to-end encryption. But as you encrypt only with a long-term public secret key, if someone gets that secret key compromised, then they will be able to decrypt any past messages and future messages. And they say, that's something we don't want. So that's the state of the art like in 2004. So what they did is that they started mapping certain properties that we needed in the modern protocols that we use. And here I will present some of the properties that all of the current secure messaging applications try to give. The first property is this property that's called forward secrecy. What is forward secrecy? Well, if in PGP you encrypted all of your messages with a long-term secret key, with forward secrecy, what you will try is that you will try to encrypt each message with a unique message key, meaning that if an attacker gets compromised on one of those keys, this attacker will not be able to decrypt any past messages. Basically, that's forward secrecy. How is this achieved? It was first introduced by the OTR protocol, and it was achieved because every time that you will send a message, you will generate a Diffie-Hellman key pair. You will encrypt that message with a shared secret derived from that Diffie-Hellman key pair, and you will send along that message advertising also your new public key. So that will mean that each message is encrypted with a unique key. We'll see later why this is a problem, but for the while, this works. The second property that is very related to the forward secrecy property is the property called post-compromise security. That means that if an attacker gets hold of one key, this attacker will not be able to compromise any future messages that you sent. So you see that they are correlated because the first one is only about past messages, this is about future messages. How is this achieved? It was first introduced by the Signal protocol, and it's sort of achieved in a way to make the Diffie-Hellman key exchange much more efficient for the derivation of the message keys. Why? Why it's really inefficient to always do a diffie-hellman monkey exchange every time you send a message? Because your computer will have to be generating a very long prime number every time that you want to send a message. So that's not really efficient. So what the Signal protocol and the Signal application actually does is that it will generate only a diffie-hellman monkey pair once you receive a message from the other party. How does it work? Let's say that I want to send a message to my friend that says hello, okay, then I will generate a diffie-hellman monkey pair. But if I want to send a message immediately after that, saying like, how are you? I will not generate a new diffie-hellman monkey pair. What I will do is that I will do a hash of the previous key and encrypt the message with that new generated hashed key and send the message along. But let's say that's the total amount of numbers that I want to send to total amount of message that I want to send my friend. And then my friend replies, hey, how are you? With a new diffie-hellman monkey pair and a new message key. Once I receive that message, now I'm able to generate a new diffie-hellman monkey pair and actually start sending messages with that new diffie-hellman. So you see why it's called, this algorithm is actually called the double ratchet algorithm, and you see why, because you have two ratchets. One ratchet for the diffie-hellman monkey exchange, and another second ratchet for when you do hashes of the previous message key that you derive. Much more efficient, because doing hashes is much more efficient computationally than actually being generating diffie-hellman monkey pairs every time. If you want to know how it works, there you have the diagram. Talk to me later if you want to know more. Okay. Yeah, so the double ratchet algorithm is actually called like a ping-pong mechanism. Why? Because you have to wait for the other party to do your diffie-hellman monkey exchange, wait for the message, and then you generate new diffie-hellman. So it's diffie-hellman by ping-pong. Now, this has its problems in the sense that you will have a window of compromise for an attacker. So for example, if an attacker figures out that you're just generating message keys by doing hashes, this attacker, if compromises one of those keys, this attacker will be able to derive all of subsequent keys until the point that you do a diffie-hellman monkey exchange and add some randomness, and then the attacker will not be able. But on the Signal protocols and other protocols that take the inspiration from the double ratchet algorithm, you will have this little window of compromise until you add a new diffie-hellman randomness. Another interesting thing about the Signal protocol is that just this year, the cryptographers have actually did a formal verification of the properties of the double ratchet algorithm. Finally, at Eurocrypt 19. So yeah, what they also find out is one of the two core interesting properties of the Signal protocol is that you will be always able to immediately decrypt any message. You don't have to wait until the correct key arrives or whatever. You will be able to always decrypt. And you will always have another property that's called message loss resilience. In the sense, if you're working on a network that, I don't know, drops packages or like does out of all the things, there will be no problem. You will always be able to decrypt the message. Why is this important? Because in the past, certain secure messaging protocols were not able to handle this. Okay, and that was the security properties. That's basically all the security properties that the current messaging application, secure messaging applications will give you. From the privacy side, there's some properties that they can give you. And the biggest one is deniability. Deniability means what? It means that anyone could have authored or said something in a conversation. It doesn't mean that you have the power to deny. It means that you can say anyone could have been part of that conversation. You have different types of deniability that we have mapped. You have online, offline message and participation, because you can deny having sent a message and you can also deny having participated in the conversation. And you also have two other properties, which is online and offline, because why? So what current old messaging protocols used to do is that they used to give you a deniability that happened after the fact. So after the fact that the conversation happened, you could say to anyone, anyone could have participated into that conversation. Anyone could have forged a transcript. Anyone could have like been there. But that was always after the conversation happened. That is why it's called offline, because it's after the conversation happened. But there's another interesting property that actually maps to the modern world that we live in. What happens if, for example, you're crossing a border and the agent of the border say, hey, surrender to me your device. I want you to put your passphrase or fingerprint or whatever you use on your device, and I'm going to start a conversation with some of your contact because I want to compromise your contact. I know you're a friend with this person that I want to compromise, so I will do that. That can actually happen. It has happened to people when crossing certain borders from certain countries. In that moment, with all the protocols, you cannot deny having said anything, or you cannot make the person who this agent is trying to compromise have the property of deniability. So now modern applications actually have this property that is called online deniability, which means that even if someone is trying to collude with you to compromise your friend, your contact, they will not be able still to provide any proof of authorship to anybody else. So even if they collude with you, that cannot be used to say, yes, indeed this person said this that compromised him and can be used to put him in jail or something worse. There you have it. Okay, if you want to get technical, how was this achieved? In the past, this was achieved by usage of a thing that's called a message authentication code. So in OTR and other related protocols, you don't sign the message in the way that you sign with PGP. What you use is that you instead use this message authentication codes to provide the integrity of the message and also to sign. And what you do is that after the fact the conversation happened, you reveal the keys that you used to generate these marks, and everybody could have taken the keys and created a conversation with them. How happens right now is that you will use a thing that's called ring signatures to actually provide deniability during a part that is called an enable authenticated exchange. So in general, how secure messaging protocols work is that you will have a part in which you send to the other party your long-term keys. After that, you generate your first shared secret, and then you start encrypting your messages. So that part in which you send long-term keys is the one that actually has to be deniable. And for that, you can use ring signatures. Want to know more about ring signatures? Find me later. Okay, and the last property that you should have in a secure messaging application is that you will have verification to indeed say, hey, I'm the holder of this long-term key, so no one else is the holder. Okay, so what's the state of the art? So this is basically most of the secure messaging protocols that exist out there. You have OTFP3, OTFP4, Signal, Omimo, Megalom, and OLM, which is the one used by Riot, I think, and Telegram. None of them actually provide in fullness all of the properties that I have just stated right now, even the version 4 of OTR, which is the one that I'm leading. Why they don't provide? Because certain properties cannot be attained by the kind of cryptographic algorithms we use. And that was important to give almost the fullness of the properties, but keep updating to new cryptographic primitives once you know that it will give fullness, much more fullness. Okay, and the state of the art on the current ones that we have, of course you have Signal, Wire, Riot, Mimo, WhatsApp. They mostly work for for conversations between two people and also for group chat. And the one that right now is being standardized to actually work end-to-end encrypted for group chat is an application that's called MLS, which is the messaging layer security, which will give us end-to-end encrypted group chat. Now, right now the state of the art is that there's some very good, nice things about these applications, but also there's some problems around there. Some of the problems are, for example, that some of the implementations of this protocol only work, for example, for desktop, when we know that right now most of the people would like to have conversations over mobile devices. So that's this problem. There are some problems also because some of these applications use a messaging protocol that right now is not that used, like, for example, XMPP, that is a little bit forgotten now. So maybe they should update. Another problem that you have, and this is what I talked at the beginning a little bit, is that now users has like a lot of applications to install. I don't know if you have this problem, but I have this problem that with my family, I have to talk WhatsApp, with someone I have to talk with Wire, with someone else I have to talk to Signal, with someone else I have to use Telegram, with someone else I have to use Riot, and there's millions of apps that I have to install. So what I actually think is maybe we should just create a way that this application might talk to each other or try to create a community and put the community together so we sort of give the same properties and they don't have to install one application per each use case. The other problem that you have is that there's no clear privacy and security properties given. There's not a cryptographic paper that actually states these are the properties that this protocol gives. These are the limitations that this protocol has. And when a user actually installs any application on the phone or whatever device, they don't know what they are getting. They just know, oh, they told me this is a nice end-to-end secure application, so I will just install it. But no one actually knows what properties they are given users. There's no good synchronization between devices. I know that a lot of people use some of this application on desktop and also on the mobile, and there's like problems. So that's still an unresolved problem. And there's also not a good mapping between the privacy and security properties and the UI that they show to the user. So you can say, from a cryptographic standpoint of view, forward secrecy and backward secrecy sounds amazing. But what happens if someone makes you unlock your device and sees your whole history of messages? Then forward secrecy and backward secrecy meant nothing because they just unlock the device and see it. So for example, actually putting something like disappearing messages, maybe actually from a UI standpoint of view, provide forward and backward secrecy. Or actually having a good way to securely delete your keys that are staying in the RAM or in the memory of whatever device you're using, also should be something to be provided. Okay, and that was a little bit of the state. And right now I'm presenting the version 4 of OTR. It's not the best protocol, but it's improved. So why we need a version 4 of OTR? OTR is one of the maybe only protocol that actually pushes forward deniability in all of the forms. So we actually need, in a way, to still be pushing forward this. We also mapped correctly all of the security properties that I just shown you, forward secrecy and post-compromise secrecy, to actually give to user. And we wanted a number of other things. As I said, we also wanted to update cryptographic primitives, because if you're using a protocol that's maybe 20 years old, maybe update to something else, because some cryptographic algorithms do get broken, so update the primitives that you're using. We also wanted to use a new communication model, because when OTR was created, it was 2004. And in 2004, you had desktop applications in which you had to wait for the other user to connect and be online to start a conversation. That's not the case anymore, right? We just want to have a mobile application in which you just send a message and whatever. That friend of you can check the message 2 days later, but still the message was sent. So we want a communication model that is online and also offline. As I said, we don't want to rely on the network being able to reorder packages and messages, but we want to actually give a way that if messages arrive out of order, they can be still decrypted. We also don't want to trust servers, because a problem that some of messaging applications have is that they relied on a centralized server in order to, I don't know, retrieve contacts, store offline messages, backup username information. But we don't want that. We just want to be able to give everyone whatever server they want to use and trust it to be able to use that. Okay. So limitations and current issues that actually almost all secure messaging applications have out there. The first one is that I talked about some of the privacy properties, but I didn't talk about one important privacy property, which is metadata protection or anonymity. There's some secure messaging applications that provide that, like Ricochet or Qt, but there's still not a really massively used chat secure application that gives you anonymity. Still something that we have to look upon. Post-quantum algorithms, right now there's an ongoing NIST competition for actually standardizing a post-quantum algorithm, so there's right now no implementation in a secure messaging application of any post-quantum algorithm. But then this competition will end up in maybe 2 years, so maybe then we will have something. Group chat support. And this is very interesting, because some applications do give you group chats, right? But they have some issues. I don't know if you have used some of these secure messaging application and you try to destroy a group, or you try to remove a person from a group. It's still something that has not been solved. Or actually giving deniability in a group chat setting is a problem that has not been solved from a cryptographic standpoint of view. I know that right now, for example, maybe a week ago, the Signal protocol actually produced a blog post in which they are trying to improve their group chat support on how they actually handle the discovery of contacts and things like that. Interesting, but there's still some work that needs to be done. So I think that you can think about it and you can actually start discussing if you are doing a secure messaging application is solve these problems, please. The synchronization of multi-device problem is still something that people need to think about. I know that your MIMO protocol has made huge steps on the XMPP community for this, so maybe a good place to start for inspiration will be there. Should messages disappear? Should no history be kept on your device? What happens if an agent makes you unlock your device and shows the whole history? Should you provide some kind of button that clears all history by default? Should you clear history by X amount of time? Should you disappear messages? Also needed to think about it. What's the impact of top properties into the underlying protocol? So for example, what happens if you use OGR on top of Tor? Will deniability work on top of anonymity? Does deniability cancel out with anonymity? It's still something needed to think about. Can there be modes for deniability? What about if a user only needs like offline deniability or doesn't need deniability at all? Something that we have been talking about with the MLS people is, for example, to provide two modes, one mode in which provide deniability and one that doesn't provide deniability at all. Do we need new protocols or actually to update existing one? Because every now and then there is a new secure messaging application that you have to install. Maybe we don't need a new one, but actually to start to get the community together, to get all of these properties and ideas together and basically have all of the properties between all of the secure messaging protocols. Do we need more apps? Maybe no. Okay, and with that, the OTA before, you can check it out. I will put the repos later. Thanks to everybody involved. This kind of research is not only mine, but of all of these people. You can check the repos. I've been told to make this slide wait a little bit longer. Okay, good. Moving on. Let's move the slide. Okay, some references. And if you want to find us, we have a website. We have an REC channel. We're supposed to have an assembly, and we also have whiskey there, so you can come. it's over there. And yeah, thank you very much. Oh, yeah. Questions? No questions. Everything's clean.
Thank you so much, Sophia. Let's give her another. Oh, wait, no, we do have one question. Wait. He's a late bloomer. He really wanted to hold on to that question for a little bit.
Hi. So how do you put the MAC into the encryption? The MAC is part of AES or whatever you use to encrypt?
No. What we use to encrypt is in previous versions of OTI, you will use AES.
Yeah.
And in the current version, you use a primitive that's called ChaCha20 without poly. The MAC, you will just only like from the Diffie-Hellman shared secret, you will do a key derivation function, maybe use shake or SHA-3 or whatever. You derive a key, and you derive this key, but also a MAC key. And that's the key used for do the MAC tag.
Okay, cool, thanks.
Yeah. Okay.
All right, let's give her another round of applause. No. Okay, we got another question. Maybe third time will be the charm on the applause, guys. I know you're ready to go.
Okay.
I have a question about whether an AAD encryption mode harmed the deniability.
Authenticated? Yeah, interesting question. Maybe, yes, because you're authenticated at the same time that you're encrypting. So probably if you want to do a protocol that's deniable, don't use that kind of primitive, but only just like an encryption primitive and then some kind of integrity authentication besides it. Might be.
Yeah, that's why I can see both OTR V3 and V4 use an encryption mode without AAD.
Okay, guys, let's hesitantly raise our hands for a second. And I think we're clear. We can give a round of applause. Thank you so much, Sophia, for coming.